your camera has a thing on it called evaluative metering. Ever seen that? You looked at your unit and said, oh, I don't need that. Evaluative metering means the camera is looking at the differences that the camera's from 80% and it's making a correction for you. That's the metering mode. If you don't have evaluative metering, then you don't have it. But when you get a better camera, it'll be in there. Okay, that's what it's for. Evaluative metering. Right. The other thing to do, if you don't have that, is you will interpret the light meter readings after evaluating the scene, and believe it or not, you know what to do. If the scene is brighter than 18%, if it's less than 18%, you know what to do. Okay? You can just say, I'm going to add light or take away light. You can do that.
But the determination of 18% does come.
That's in the camera. That's the given.
The scenario is the photo frame does not average 18%.
Most of them do. For most of the time, what you're seeing in a viewfinder, that's why it's set at 18%. Most of the time it does. And most of the time you take exposure.
But when that's true, the top.
Yeah.
The way you tell it is by the histogram?
You can tell it by the histogram. You didn't used to be able to do that, you had to change. But now you can tell by the histogram. If the histogram is perfectly right in the middle, it's 18%. If it's a little skewed one way or the other, it's a little off. Now that doesn't mean it's wrong, it's just a little off. Okay? Alright. The last one is you will interpret your digital histogram. We talked about that. Remember, if it's not cut off on either side, everything in there is what you need. If you want to tweak it a little bit, you can tweak it in the camera, you can tweak it in your computer. But if it's cut off on either side, information is gone. And you're pretty much screwed. You can't do it. Okay. So these are all true and ways to get the exposure. Now the ones we're going to use is the interpretation of your histogram. Because that's the 21st century technology. We're not going to worry about all this other stuff. So what do incorrect exposures look like? What color is snow? 18% gray? That's 18% gray because the camera saw it as, even though it's white, it sets it at 18% gray. And so if you match the needle, if you do what the camera says, that's what you're going to get. Anybody have trouble in bright sunny days and snow? You get the images that are too dark because the camera's making it 18% gray. Mm-hmm. Or you have good things that are silhouettes that you thought shouldn't have been silhouettes. That's why, because the background is too bright. Camera's setting it everything at 18%. So meter reading, both of them are wrong. Okay. So water and snow are both often brighter than 18%, so to get the correct exposure, you have to give the camera some light. And the only way to give it is to physically say, here, I'm going to change either aperture or f-stop independently of the other to let more light in. Otherwise, it'll never happen. Okay? That's what you have to do. That's what the little plus or minus exposure button is for. Okay? Confronted with these two scenes. This is the meter reading, and it turned out to be okay. Okay? It turned out to be okay because this is brighter than normal, this was darker than normal, but together they averaged about right. This one? No. This would have been too dark. So added a little bit more light. Otherwise, this bird would have been gray. Okay? The tone of 18% reflection. I know this is all very confused, but it's not confusing at all. It's just brighter than neutral, add light, darker than neutral. Alright, so what's the person do? Bracket exposure like crazy and hope for the best? By the the best camera, the best media system you can, and trust it implicitly. Then just learn a few simple rules and then trust your own judgment, okay? If you have the best media system or the best media system you can buy, it still can make mistakes, okay? I've got high-end equipment over here and it still has to be adjusted, okay? Not as much as it used to be, but still has to be adjusted. So no, you can do that, I don't care, but pretty expensive. Yes. All right. So, right here, huh? We didn't, did we? This is in your, and this on the CD.
It's on the CD.
So, if the subject is 18%, you don't have to do anything. If it's any of these, you have to do these. And these are F stops, you know, remember F, you know. You never have to do this, you never want something that's dead right, and you really never want something so dark you can't see details. So you can throw out 7, throw out 1, and you're operating within a 1F stop to 1.5F stop on either side. So it's not a lot of changing to make this, just tweaking. All you gotta do is tweak. So basically I operate within this setting right here. A little bit darker, a little bit lighter. As long as the histogram is in the center of those two lines, you're okay. There we go. And the good news is your camera meter will likely make adjustments within this range, so you won't have to worry about it. Okay? It has enough range. If you're using a little thing called evaluative meter, if you don't use that, then it won't. Okay. Which one of those is correct? This is correct. This is a half F stop overexposed, that's a half F stop underexposed. Does it make any difference? Not so much. Okay? Who cares? There's a range. If you were gonna use it in a slideshow, you do this one. If you're gonna print it, use this one. If you're going to, I don't know what I would use that one for, but you know, it's not wrong. So, you need to know what your camera's capable of doing. If it's consistently giving you too bright or too dark, then you need to know that it's consistently going to do that. Okay? And you need to look at your histogram. Learn to interpret your digital histogram, and more importantly, learn how to adjust it to change it. Okay? And it's not intuitive. We always end up doing the opposite of what it thinks. So if you take a picture and you see the histogram and half of it's cut off on a white side, you got to take away light. If it's half of it's on the dark side, you got to add light. Okay? So, if it looks like this, you're in business, no problem. If it looks like this, you're still in business, but you're gonna have to make an adjustment in the computer. If you don't have it in the computer, then you have to make it in the camera. If it looks like this, so this is that hair and down here, this is the center hair, and this is the hair on the other side. But because none of these are cut off, it's perfectly acceptable and perfectly salvageable because all the information is there. Okay, so which histogram goes with which photograph? How about this one? This one. How about this one? See, it's not wrong. What's this one? See how that? The histogram is physics. It's infallible. It tells you what's there. Okay? What's there? All right. So, single most important thing for a period of time is alertly, critically evaluate your own work. Is this too dark? Is this too light? And fix it. Okay? You study them, you learn from them, and then if they're no good, well, I might need that for some time. Well, you might. You might draw from, you know, but don't save everything simply because, well, I took it, it's sacred. It's not. You know, delete or whatever you want to, you know, used to be throw the slide away or throw the print away. Now you just say, okay, I didn't do that right. Here's what I need to do to change it, and you have immediate gratification of how to change it. Okay, so that's, you know, you don't have to worry about why it happens. You just have to know that it happens, and it happens to everybody the same way. Any questions about that?
So
the answer to all your questions is going to be histogram.
When the histogram is, you're saying, cut off.
When it's cut off in either direction, there's something wrong with your exposure.
And it's the way it looks on the plan that you can see it.
Yeah, there's no, there should be some sort of bell shape, and none of the black part should be truncated. Right. And if it is, something is functioning. And it's simply because that the image was outside of the 18%, and it was outside far enough that your meter couldn't deal with it. That's all it's telling you. Okay? And the smaller and the simpler your camera, the less sophisticated the meter is going to be. The simplest meters in your camera are better than the meters in the most sophisticated film cameras of 20 years ago. Well, that's the good news. So unless you're getting consistently funky images, don't worry about it. But you need to know, if you're not, how to fix it, okay?
Can you explain, some people may not know that if you right-click on the image while it's showing in your computer, you can then finally get the details.
Yeah, if you pick on info, it'll show you all of this stuff right there. Right next to the camera, it'll have the histogram, it'll have the aperture f-stop, so you can see all this stuff. And you don't have to do that very often, you just do it intuitively, you know. So, but that's why all that information is in there. It's important. And it's in there. And if you load it in a computer, and when you stick it in Photoshop or Photoshop Elements, all that information is right there. Aperture, f-stop, lens type, all that kind of stuff. And it's not just to say, oh, look, it blows up for. It's to tell you something, all right? And if you know, you have to know how to read it. It's like the Dewey Decimal System. If you don't know how the Dewey Decimal System works, you never find a book in the library, right?
Well, in the PC, you don't even have to go into a special program.
No.
You just right-click and choose
copy. Yep. I'm a Mac person, so I don't know, but for Mac, it's the same way, okay? All right. Okay. So then we talked about exposure. Here's something a little bit specialized. And even those of you that have point-and-shoot cameras can use this information. It's called filters. You ever look at a photo catalog with like 17 pages of filters? Most of those are for like gimmick photographers, like wedding photographers and bride, you know, and those sorts of things. We're going to talk about nature photography. Filters. Then with special effects filters to do everything from create starbursts to 62 images, you know, like an ant's looking at it. For the nature photographer, there's only three that are relative: the neutral density filter, the split neutral density filter, and the polarizing filter. They're all pretty simple. I'm going to show you what they mean. Those three are what's important. If you're going to buy filters, you don't need any of them, but I'm showing what they do. Why you might need them. All right, neutral density filter. All right, it's a filter that you put over the lens. If you look at it, it's gray. It's gray. And even if you have a point and shoot, you have no way to attach a filter, you can still hold it in front of the lens. It still works, you know. You just hold it there. You made the filter holder. Why would you want to do that? You're fighting for light. Why would you ever want to cut the amount of light that comes to the camera? Well, this removes one f-stop, that one removes two. I think they go up to like three or four different f-stops of light. So it just makes the image darker. But make the image dark, it makes the amount of light coming in less. Why would you want to do that? Well, anybody like filming waterfalls? What if it's too darn bright? You set the camera to the least sensitive, and you're shooting at f/16 at a 250th of a second. That's the lowest it'll go. What are you gonna do? Wait till the sun goes down? Yeah. Or you can cut the amount of light coming into the camera. Okay? You can simply cut the amount of light into the camera, which means you can shoot at a slow enough shutter speed that the water will move, you know. So it's a very specialized kind of filter. Do all of you need those? No. But that's what it does. Okay? That's what it does. That's what it's for. Do I have any?